all of that development and all of that energy of the 60s, for me specifically, as for others, was a time of tremendous personal individual change, especially in myself, and I see it in many others, simply because of the energy of the day, having to do with all of the issues around political and social matters. So my development perhaps connects to that point in time when tremendous questions on African Americans and probably others, and some maybe perhaps even today, it became even more important that I find ways to express myself. So the arts became the way to express myself. I had delusions of being a great fine artist, historical figure in the art. Visualize myself as being that kind of fine artist, influenced by all kinds of things that I read relative to the arts.
My name is Curtis Barnes Jr. I guess the name is kind of a giveaway to who I am. I am the son of Curtis Barnes Sr. My favorite artist in the entire world, a man whom which I grew up watching from the steps of the tomb, his studio, and those memories are so embedded in my brain, I can never get rid of or not think of him every day painting religiously in front of his easel, day and night, just being so prolific and creating work. And I just sat there every day wondering what captivated him so much, what made him want to be there all day, every day, without fail. And so I'm that guy. I'm that little guy that watched him create masterpieces, some of which he didn't consider that, but I consider them all just great pieces of work. I'm that guy who watched him paint and grew up to become just a lover of everything he did.
I met Curtis because he was one of the outstanding elementary art teachers while I was in high school. So I don't remember the exact year that he started teaching, but right from the beginning, he was just a great teacher and a great friend. And being so few African-American male art teachers, we sort of hung together and did a lot of collaborating and working together. But we were just really tight right from the beginning and had a great respect for him because he was a master teacher almost from the beginning. He just taught with such passion and love and concern for students that he was just an appealing person to be around.
There's three stages of my engagement with Curtis. Very first stage as a student in high school, as a youngster. Very first time I saw an African-American visual artist who was actually working, okay, committed and highly developed.
He would go off in very impassioned lectures off the top of his head about Picasso and Matisse and color and shape and form. And it was so lively and engaging the way that he talked about art. I think it was different than the way anybody else did that the students had had.
His voice was so encouraging. His presence was a I want to say like a benevolent influence. You respected the man, but at the same time you felt like you could talk to him. You felt like you could relate to him. He was very down to earth in a very informed kind of way, and so it was inspiring.
He would tell me that I paint alongside them because I'm just like them. I'm a painter. I'm an artist first. And he said, I want them to critique me as well. As I critique them and tell them what I see, I want them to tell me what they see and what I'm doing. And whatever they can pick up from me, I'm picking up things from them, you know, as well as, you know, hoping they can see what I'm doing. So he, you know, he enjoyed that. He just wanted to be a part of what they were doing, and not just talk about it. You know, he wanted to be a part of it, and that just makes him, you know, special. Just to know that he allows students to say, "I don't like that," or "Oh, why did you do that?" So he can show them directly instead of tell them. He can show them, "Hey, because this composition is based on whatever it may have been." So he appreciated being a part of the whole the entire process.
Curtis was an incredible teacher. I saw him work with hundreds of students over the years, and they all loved him. But he would have these incredible dialogues with students in the studio. He'd have 20 or 25 students in there, and he'd be walking in between them and just have these wonderful dialogues on art, on life, on philosophy, on music, and they would get pretty deep.
Curtis was an amazing professor. He not only taught the things artists are supposed to learn, but he also kind of taught philosophy. I mean, he talked about both the joys and the responsibilities of being an artist, you know, the things an artist owed their audience. You know, you needed to make sure when somebody viewed your work that they came away from it with a slightly different view of the world.
What I remember mostly and what I loved mostly was his concern for his fellow artists. We talk about the African-American Visual Artists Guild, which is in its now 27th or 28th year of existence, consecutive years of existence. But people forget, Curtis has always been supportive and nurturing of artists. And there was two other organizations that Curtis started with other individuals in the community called Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. Those were the arts organization that Curtis helped to pull together in the community to just to get artists talking and sharing and collaborating together and growing together.
When I was growing up, there was the art group in which he established Genesis 3, which was a collection of Black artists throughout the Dayton, the West Side.
The African American Visual Artists Guild, a lovely organization that I still work with from time to time. But I started working with them by way of the art day that they have, the community art day. At the time, I didn't know that this was the brainchild of Curtis Barnes and Willis Bean Davis.
I didn't know just the full depth of his love, not only for art and other artists, but also community. Curtis would rally the young kids around and take them into his studio and taught art to them as part of his community commitment. Not to mention all the many neighbors that he painted portraits of and documented in a beautiful way, who most of them thought that who am I to be a subject matter for you? But he lifted them up and made these wonderful series, and some I never even saw them all.
Curtis would challenge you in a lot of ways. I can say this when it came to being an influence. He always responded to my drawings. He always responded and just said, "Oh, this is powerful." But then I started painting. Curtis looked at him. He said, "Dwayne," he said, "when are you gonna put some paint on there?" I said, "The drawing is nice, but you got to put some paint on there, man." "So what are you going to do? You got to go back. You got to scratch your head. You got to go back and you got to find some paint to put on there." So of course, Curtis would challenge. Curtis would challenge anyone. So no. To know Curtis was to be challenged.
And you know, there's another factor too that made him an artist. There was only a few, even today, a few of my artist friends that you could call and for hours talk about a shade of blue, or a yellow, or an orange, or a mask. And Curtis was one of those few artist in my life that you can have a conversation with about so much aspect and this minute aspects of art that other people would find boring. A line in a painting, or a shadow in a painting, or an accent color in an eye. And he would make you see it and make you love it, just by how he would describe it. Very special.
The students were mesmerized with his words when he was talking. One of his students, Cindy Tiedemann, had a great quote I thought about Curtis. She said, "Curtis Barnes was nothing but encouraging, like sunshine on a plant." And that's just so true.
Curtis pointed at me and he said, "Well, what an artist like Pat would do," and I did not hear the rest of the conversation. Curtis Barnes had just referred to me as an artist. Up until that point, I thought of myself as somebody who wanted to be an artist, who was working to be an artist. But the fact that he acknowledged me as an artist, that was the moment I became an artist. I started to think of myself as an artist that day.
And I, to this day, still run into individuals when I'm traveling. They say, here I'm from Dayton, and they're involved with art. And they'll say, "Did you know Curtis Barnes?" Or, "I had a class with Curtis Barnes." And these are artists, but also are individuals who just took art as an elective or humanities, or just to take a course from Curtis. He was a special artist.
One of the most beautiful things about Curtis, okay, was he was in constant search of that common denominator, okay? Whether it was between images, whether it was between people, whether it was between almost anything in existence. Because you also heard Curtis talk a lot about the cosmos. Okay? And that's where he was when it came to that overall connectivity. Everything is everything. And he lived in that. He lived that. Okay? He believed that. He shared that. He made you feel that. And his paintings represent that. Mm-hmm. So that's why, that's my belief as to why we experience the fearlessness, just the desire to replicate that. Because the paintings are pretty much a byproduct of the way he processed information. It's not the other way around.
Without Curtis Jr., I would have never been, you know, really aware of the work the way I am, and in any part of it. And I know it shaped me as a young artist, just being aware of this, and now getting older and being able to really be in touch with it. You know, it's something really, really special, really magical, being able to be around this much art. You know, this many paintings that aren't yours, this many great paintings, and getting your nose right up to them has been quite the experience, and I certainly don't think it's over yet.
I hate to use the word underappreciated, and I feel that it's only underappreciated because the lack of exposure. Once the masses, if you will, outside of this the Dayton area or this region is aware of the work, then the underappreciation goes away. So that's always been the goal. His legacy for me and my family is already established. I mean, we know the greatness of his work. And so it's all about just having that extended beyond the borders of the Dayton, Ohio region.